Before the audition, and I really loved it.
I read the script first, and I loved the story. So I think that was the number one thing.
I always wanted to act for an Asian American play, and it's a very rare opportunity.
It's not often that there specifically works about people of color.
Philip and I started working on this play when he was first commissioned by the American Conservatory Theater, and I was an actor in their acting company.
Stephen Anthony Jones, the director, has had a long, storied, successful career in theater, in film, and television, so I learned a lot from him in and out of the rehearsal hall.
Philip, having him there, it's been a great experience because you literally have the playwright right there to be like, hey, so about this, what does that mean? What does that mean? Or what were you thinking of this? And sometimes he'll tell you, and sometimes he'll just be like, how about you figure it out? And then I go, oh, I did figure it out. So thanks for telling me to figure it out.
It took us 2 years to develop that first version.
And after the production, which I was very happy with, I wanted to go back and do it again. You know, it usually takes 3 productions to get a play right for me.
And I feel very close both to this play and to Philip. We enjoy working together. And when this opportunity came up, he called me and I jumped at it. Yeah.
But together, we were able to sit down and think about the play, reconceive it, and add a lot of elements that weren't in the original production.
After World War II, when Japanese had gotten thrown into internment camps, in their absence, other minorities had moved into what they call like Japanese towns. And then when they returned, they began to push out those minorities. So my character is one of those few families who's kind of left in living in one of these Japanese towns, who kind of just doesn't belong there anymore.
Japanese Americans get out of the camps, come back, and they want their community back.
My character is one of those Japanese Americans. He's a second generation Japanese American who is returning to San Francisco to run the rooming house. He's just someone who wants to be taken for what he is, which is a passionate, jazz playing, jovial fellow who just wants to live life as an American with his fellow Americans.
And so it's this moment historically where they kind of intersect, and they're both very disenfranchised communities. You know, Japanese Americans have gotten out of imprisonment. They don't even know if they're American citizens.
Why can't no need to have a reason? Change the rules to suit yourself. This case for everybody's good. Like him. Especially during wartime.
African Americans come back and they find out that, you know, they can't get buried in military cemeteries. They're segregated. The jobs that they had at the docks building ships over here in Richmond are drying up, and the first people that are taken are, you know, released are the African Americans. And so the climb for the African Americans is getting, you know, just unsettled. And so these two communities intersect at that moment, and I thought, this is a really interesting thing to sort of investigate.
The music that's throughout the piece is just awesome.
So we have live blues singing, a horn player, and then what we did also is I began thinking, if he's going to sing the blues, what would his lyrics be? And then I thought, during the internment camp for Japanese Americans, some of the internees wrote haiku, these Japanese poems, and there's a book published, and I rewrote some of them, and so now those are the lyrics that the blues singer sings.
Trudging through the snow, no word is spoke. Railroad tracks, surging curves.
And it's a perfect, you know, the idea that haiku has a very strict form, very simple, and that the blues format also is very basic. And so now the blues singer sings songs with these internment camp lyrics. It's very cool. I like it a lot.
There's a lot that goes underneath the text that as an audience member, I may not have caught without, you know, like as an actor in the production, there's certain things that Philip and Stephen have pointed out to us that we just take for granted, right? There's a scene between Earl and Chet, the two leads, right? The black lead and the Japanese-American lead. And there's this ease of talking to each other that that's there, but there's still this tension underneath.
I've gone back and looked at that, the relationship of the two communities, and I wanted to make them a little rawer.
I study urban revitalization, you know, urban kind of planning, stuff that deal with class and racial discriminations and tensions. And then in this play, in the context, is where the government tried to build new projects in a relatively lower income neighborhood in order to make the place vitalized and better. But it always brings about a lot of social inequity issues, which is which has been something that I'm always concerned about. And I get to act it, and I think it's great. I've been telling my people in my majors to come over and watch. It happens in the past, which is documented in this play, and it also happens right now. Right around
it. It's a complex story. And of course, I hope the first thing that they will get will be an enjoyable evening in the theater.
You know, the idea is you can, for my end, I get to try more things because it's not a professional production. You know, there's margin for being creative and perhaps, you know, not necessarily being quite as commercial, which is good.
I want people to just think about what natural abilities they have and what they can bring to the stage, and if they can, seeing more theater, encouraging their friends to see more theater, especially works of color.
It's an opportunity to revisit it, and I'm excited, and I know folks will enjoy the production.